on this edition of the Cubs Talk Podcast, brought to you by Wintrust, home of Cubs checking, the free ATMs nationwide. Gordon Wittenmyer, Maddie Lee, Tim Stebbins, and I talk about Javy Báez meeting the media on Zoom and his frame of mind going into baseball 2021, his last as property of the Chicago Cubs. We talk about Joc Pederson's arrival and the phone call that he got from a particular teammate.
Let's play two.
Way back, it might be, it could be, it is. Holy cow!
The fly, he scores! Kaplan!
Ball! Game! Over! Cubs win!
Welcome to another fun-filled edition of the Cubs Talk Podcast, brought to you by Wintrust, home of Cubs checking, with free ATMs nationwide. With Maddie Lee, Tim Stebbins, Gordon Wittenmyer, who's on location at spring training in Mesa, Arizona, and our producers, Tony Gill and Joe Collins. I'm David Kaplan. All right, every day, guys, we get access to different members of the Cubs organization, whether that is David Ross, basically every day, different players. And today, Javy Báez spoke. And Gordon, you were out there. Javy is in great shape always, but I hear he looks even better than he did a year ago. What's your take on where Javy is? Because he had a rough 2020.
He said on today's Zoom that he's happy, he's excited. And what I've seen on the field, it shows. But it's kind of with a lot of these guys. I think, especially the guys that had bad years like Javy did last year, I think they're just happy to put it all behind him, get out in the sunshine again, start playing baseball. He's looking forward to what it's going to amount to pretty much a full spring training schedule and what he hopes is a full season of games. And that's got him in a good mindset. It is showing with a lot of these guys on the field, even more than other spring trainings. You see a bounce in their work. So I do think that's real. And I think that you're looking at Javy being in a obviously much better place than he was a year ago. And there's multiple layers and factors to that. I think Tim wrote about some of it or is going to write about some of it, Maddie too. He looks great.
Tim, do you think that there is a chance that at least 2 years, maybe three, we start thinking of the end of the run of this core? And going into last year, this is the last hurrah, everybody's going to be gone, and yet every offseason, nobody's gone till this year Schwarber was non-tendered. Everyone else is still here. Now, this is the end of the run, because Jed has said, we can't sign everybody, and this is the last year for everyone but Contreras under control in that core. Do you think they really, this time, it'll be different for that reason, especially for a guy like Javy?
I encourage our listeners to check out Maddie's article on NBCSportsChicago.com. Chris Bryant addressed this. He literally said, it seems like the talk every year is this the last hurrah? Is this it? It is like a broken record every single year. I don't know what else to say. So to your point, Cap, that is kind of the vibe every year. I think what is different this year, though, is that now there's a timeline in a way, right? Like, this fall, after October, November, these guys are going to be free agents. So in years past, talking about the last hurrah was more with regards to in the near future, they could be traded. Now it's like either you extend them, and in Javy Báez's case, he said he'd probably want to do it in spring training and not let it leak into the season. But if you don't extend them, you could always do it in the offseason, sure. But then there is literally going to be open season where they're on the open market, and there's no guarantees at that point that any of them will be.
Yeah, and Javy,
how about you,
he
Maddie?
Reiterated, which we've heard some of this before, but he said it several times today that he wants to stay with the Cubs. He's straight out said, I do not want to play for another team. Obviously, we have to see how those extension talks will go. And, you know, all of these guys have said the right things in terms of, you know, ready to start those, happy to listen. But I think those will be fascinating to watch going forward, because if I'm the Cubs, Javy's the one who I'm really prioritizing. And next year's free agent market is going to be fascinating. We've talked about all the fantastic shortstops that are going to be in that free agent class. And Javy today said, I just let my play speak for itself. That's not really on his radar, but it's got to be on his agent's radar.
It's on his radar. So cool. You can tell just by the way he answered that question. He knows exactly who's out there and how many of them. And he said, well, I'll let my game do my talking. But at the same time, he's identifying the market before anybody even asks him about it. He knows that there's a ton of them out there. And he said, but there's 29 other teams too, and I don't think they're all going to sign their shortstops back. So he knows what's going on.
So, Gordon, last year, Javy said, I didn't have any energy from the fans. I couldn't go in and watch video to make adjustments. And we saw a lot of the tendencies that were plaguing him early in his Cubs career, waving at sliders in the dirt 3 feet off the plate. He was swinging at fastballs up in his eyes. He just wasn't the guy that was second for MVP, the guy that everyone went, wow, what an amazing player. So what do you expect out of him this year?
Well, I think what happened was, like, he said he wasn't mentally prepared for what wound up happening last year. And I think what he's talking about is the shutdown, the ramp up, and then the fact that there was no video. He was completely out of his routine, and then there were no fans. He said not having fans, it was the worst. So there are going to be some fans in the stands, and even if it's a 20% capacity thing, that's a massive difference. That's more people than you get in Pittsburgh or Cincinnati when these guys go there and play. So that's going to be a real difference maker, I think. So is the video. Also, having gone through it, I think, is going to matter. So I really believe that I don't know why we wouldn't assume that he will return roughly to the same player he was before all that weirdness last year. I mean, I don't know any reason why he wouldn't. And he's especially motivated to do well, too, and to prepare well for this season. So it might even be a little bit bigger than what we've seen in the past.
Okay, let me interrupt. After the 16 season, many of us thought, oh, boy, how many rings can this crew win together? And then 17 there.
I mean,
but I'm talking about the offensive struggles. Well, there's no reason they're not going to hit return to form. We're still waiting.
Well, dude, you asked me about Javy, right? And Javy in 2018 was an MVP runner-up. In 2019, he was in the MVP race, too. And then he missed the last month with an injury. So he's on a good career track. And the only reason to think that he might not return to that career track is if you give any credence at all to a 60-game weird-ass season. I mean, there's no reason to think that that means anything. Now, there were all kinds of very real changes that occurred that impacted him in some cases more than other players. So I just don't see why you wouldn't think he would be at least the same player he was before last year.
It's also interesting that you bring up that 2016 season, because Javy addressed this and I think was more open about it than we've seen before. He talked about how, you know, these guys, a lot came with winning that World Series beyond just the baseball, right? Suddenly they're massive celebrities. Javy's doing the body issue. David Ross is dancing with the stars, you know? And so Javy talked about today, in the aftermath of that, kind of being mentally pulled away from the game. And he said he feels like the last couple years he's been able to really focus in and be really hungry and mentally sharpen that attention to baseball. And he said that's part of why last season was so frustrating for him, because he was so dialed in, but there's so many other factors and it was such a short season that we didn't see that translate to the field. But I absolutely expect to see some of that this year.
Tim, do you think if you look at the 2016 team that we could look back and go, yeah, it was an awesome season, but that was the outlier. That wasn't really who they are, because they weren't that in 17, 18, 19, 20, pandemic. We'll see what they are in 21. But is 16 the outlier? or is 16 what that team should be?
I wouldn't say I would call it an outlier, but I think we can all have the consensus that for them in 2016, everything went right, except Kyle Schwarber obviously tearing his ACL early in the season. But the starting rotation was healthy throughout the year. And outside of like a period, I think in June, July, where Dexter Fowler got hurt, hamstring injury, they just rolled from start to finish. So I don't say that's an outlier, because in 2017, they get to the NLCS after a brutal first half or underperforming first half. In 2018, they did underperform like offensively, you know, in the second half, but they still win 95 games, and it took a magical Brewer September to take the division. And then 2019, they missed the playoffs, 2020, the pandemic. But outlier, no. And maybe we could have said we all expected them to win possibly more than one World Series, but I think that year is just so unique in its own right, and they still had a lot of success. But bottom line is, it's just hard to win multiple World Series. When is the last time someone did repeat as World Series champions? It's probably been 20, 25 years by now. And even the Dodgers.
That was
someone...
the Yankees at the turn of the century.
Exactly. And even the Dodgers we always tout as this model franchise, but it took them 32 years between World Series, even though they've won all these divisions and had all this success the last 10 years.
With all due respect to my esteemed colleague, Tim Stebbins, I think it's absolutely an outlier. I think it already is, no matter what happens this year, because even if they go on some kind of weird, unexpected tear and win a World Series this year, it's going to be with almost entirely different pitching staff. It's going to be for some weird reason that we can't foresee right now. And so it won't even relate to the 6 years prior to this. But if you look at that 6 year run, that all of which included John Lester and the first half of which included Jake Arrieta, then I think there's no doubt that 2016 was an outlier. Now, by the strict definition of the word, right? Because they arrived a year early, and it was a steep, steep decline after that. Maybe because they arrived a year early with a whole bunch of guys that were rookies and second year players who maybe didn't know how to handle what amounted to maybe the most celebrated team championship in American sports history. So all of these things come into play, but 16 definitely became the outlier, if only because of all the expectations and easy talk of dynasties, and that history has already been written.
It's a good point. Everyone thought there's a dynasty coming here, and that core is going to be – I remember people saying, boy, the Yankees had Bernie Williams and Posada and Jeter, and that's what the Cubs are going to be. And it just never materialized, right?
Yeah, and maybe to Gordon's point, like, okay, so maybe outlier is by definition the word, but I think that's just kind of a tough way to look at it. But obviously then hearing Gordon say, like, fine, yes, outlier, they win 103 games. They haven't won that many since. But I think my answer is more like, I don't think that's the right way to look at it, I guess.
Well, and I think to back up Tim's first point, since he's wavering from it, I think if we're talking about outlier in terms of what this offensive core can do, I think that especially the last couple of years, they haven't lived up to their own talent. I think that what we saw offensively in 16 is something that they should have been able to replicate. And now we're looking at,
yeah, but hold on. Let me interrupt you, Maddie. Said they haven't been able to replicate the last couple years. I'll argue with you. They were okay offensively in 15, pretty good. They got really good pitching, and then they got swept by the Mets, but you know, they were just emerging. 16, they were phenomenal offensively. They've never been good offensively since. That's 17, 18, 19, 20.
Right, but you're looking at 15, all super young, right? And you're seeing them develop and seeing them come together in 16 and seeing what their potential is. I do think that they should have been able to carry that through at least another couple years.
Yeah, to lead off.
Just purely because of...
What's the big difference in the offense? They had Dexter Fowler in 15 and 16, which probably...
Gordon, do you think changing all the hitting coaches
Absolutely.
Was a mistake moving on from John Mailey?
Absolutely. And I think they probably realized it too, not long after that, especially when all of a sudden Chili Davis supposedly can't reach the millennials when he's trying to send a message that they hired him to deliver, and then to turn around and kick him to the curb sent, I think, the absolute wrong message to that clubhouse that you guys are in charge. And I that, a huge mistake. If you hired this guy to send a message, let him send his message. And if these guys won't listen to it, kick him in the ass. That's what they should have done. And they didn't come close to doing that. They just kept rotating hitting coaches in and out of there. I think that was terrible. And then to my Dexter Fowler point, having a leadoff hitter, not many teams have a leadoff hitter. And over the course of 162 games and 6 months of a season, if you have a good lineup, otherwise you're probably going to be okay. It might not show up. It might show up a lot more in the postseason. When you get into these series against really good pitching and short series, and every at bat, every inning, every game matters so much. And then we saw how they got pitched to and what the results were.
All right, let's talk about Joc Pederson. He brings a lot of people say, boy, you got the same guy that Kyle Schwarber was. You just changed the names on the uniform. I'm not sure I quite agree with that. I think he's a little bit better defensively. I think he's a little bit better contact guy. His strikeouts are below league average. I think Kyle's was above league average, but their numbers are similar. What did you guys think from what you heard from Joc Pederson today? Maddie?
Well, my favorite anecdote, we've learned a lot about Joc Pederson even before we talked to him for the first time, because he had an awesome article in the Players Tribune, which kind of laid out his journey to get to the Cubs, which we got to dive into a little more today. And I think what stands out just about where his head is at coming in here is we know that he wants to be an everyday player. He wants to prove that he can be an everyday player, not just for this year, but for his career. And, you know, he's looking at free agency next year as well. So in this 1 year with the Cubs, that's what he's out to prove. And the Cubs love that. And it'll be fun to see him kind of develop that sort of, I guess, swagger or rapport or whatever you want to call it, as he's able to actually get at bats against lefties, because those have been few and far between for him over.
Let me add something to that. You guys know I'm like a glass half full guy. But if this guy comes in who hasn't had a track record of playing every day and hitting against left-handers, and he alluded to the Dodgers' depth and their methods of platooning for matchups with most of their players. If he comes in here after getting promises of playing every day against left-handers and so on and so forth, and he threw out July is something that came up in a conversation with him and David Ross early on, that if it's not working in July, hey, we're still here trying to win. So, you know, you may find some bench at that point. But I'm here to tell you, if he's not hitting in July left-handers, and that's when he gets benched, they're probably in trouble. And then you're looking at, the net result of swapping out Schwarber for Pederson offensively could wind up being a negative too. So I don't know. It's kind of interesting to me that the Cubs are taking a gamble here. It's a big gamble. And I think they're taking this gamble because he fell into their lap. He went to them after talking to some other teams about even multi-year offers, and they backed off of the everyday playing time promise. And he said he went through rosters and looked where there would be a good fit. And he approached the Cubs, and they didn't think they were going to be in the market for a player of his caliber, literally an all-star caliber power bat. And because they were, he was willing to come in on a one-year deal, a deal they could afford. The risk side for them that they were willing to take and commit to is this opportunity to play every day. But it is without a doubt a risk, and it could hurt the lineup. If they do commit to that for multiple months and he doesn't produce against left-handers.
But when you say hurt the lineup, it can't be worse than what it was with Schwarber, who, yes, he gave you power. I think you'll get that out of Joc Pederson. Schwarber really disappointed them in terms of being
what
a contact
I'm talking
guy,
about,
when you agree.
When I say hurt the lineup and be a net result offensively that's worse than Schwarber, what I mean by that is he'll be facing the hitters that Schwarber would have been benched against, that other hitters with better matchups, with better splits against, would be in there against. And you're not, and by the way, Peterson's going to come in with similar numbers against left-handers that Schwarber had, maybe a little better. I don't know, a small sample size either way, but it's a risk. So if he's still going to play and they're going to commit to playing time as he struggles to battle against these left-handers that he's having a tough time hitting, then that's a spot in the order in those games that you would have otherwise had a bat in there who could probably better handle it, probably from the right side. But you've made this commitment to this guy. There's a risk.
I don't know, Gordon. It wasn't that much of a platoon last year, and they have been pretty straightforward with him, with Joc, saying, look, if you're going to get an off day, we're probably going to have it be against a big lefty, like just because that,
well,
like,
get that's some what makes off sense. Days, right? I mean, everybody gets some off days, even Rizzo does, and those will be the days, no doubt, but he's going to get a steady diet of whatever left-handers they wind up facing.
Yeah, I just don't see it as being that much different from how they use Schwarber.
I agree. I don't think it's going to be different, like Maddie's saying, because Schwarber seemingly was the everyday guy out there last year. And if we're talking about numbers against lefties, Peterson's are actually slightly worse for his career. Outside of, I believe, the strikeout rate, he's got a slightly lower strikeout rate. I think Jed Hoyer said, like, what they like about him is, and this wasn't directly comparing him to Schwarber, though, was the ability to hit the high fastball. And that's kind of a dynamic to this lineup that they've been looking for. Like the steady diet of high fastballs, off speed pitches the Cubs have gotten in recent years. Clearly there's been trouble with that. And maybe that's something that he can help them with in that regard. But like we're saying, the numbers are pretty similar in terms of lefties, and Schwarber is someone who got run out there for it. So we'll see how Peterson fares in that regard.
See how it goes.
Before we wrap this up, did he not talk also about a phone call from Jason Hayward?
You mean the guy with big nuts?
Oh, my God.
Tell that story quickly.
You want to tell it, Tim?
Yeah, so Joc Pederson, like, it was, I think, January that he signed, and he got a random phone call from a Chicago number. And this is kind of in the spirit of random phone calls and messages this week. Chris Bryant got a random text from a Connecticut number saying, welcome to the Mets this offseason. And Joc Pederson got a random Chicago phone call, he said, and he thought it was like maybe a trainer or someone with the Cubs, and it was Hayward. And it was Hayward just saying, hey, man, congrats, like, welcome to the team. And I think we can all agree that just speaks to like how, like, Hayward is a guy and how he is as a person.
He's never met him either.
He never met him. So that was another thing. He never met him. And it speaks to how just like classy Jason Hayward is. Like, we know him to be a leader in this group. So it wasn't a trainer. It was Jason Hayward. And like Gordon said, Joc Pederson said something along the lines of, that took big nuts, or paraphrasing something like that.
Basically, and, yeah, he said that he got texts from other guys. And that's probably how he would have approached someone new coming to the team. But doing the actual, like, cold phone call, that took, I'm going to say, guts. But
that's not what he said.
That's not what he said.
He said he was blunt. Yeah, Joc Pederson said
he was blunt. That's why I love Jason Hayward, because I think the art of picking up a phone and calling people is something that is dying, and it's sad to me that it's, I'll text you, I'll shoot you a Snapchat, I'll tweet at you, I'll DM you, I'll Instagram you. Pick up the damn phone and go, hey, man, I'm one of the leaders in that room. We're really excited you're going to be here. You let me know. You need anything, I got your back. That's so much better.
He often gets kind of left out in that conversation, too, when people talk about Rizzo as a leader or John Lester before he left. But this is fast becoming, if it's not Hayward's clubhouse, it's as much Hayward's clubhouse as it is anybody's. He's been there since the championship year, and he's got at least as much respect in that room as any other player in there.
Yeah, you could really see with Mills's, I'll make this quick, I know we're running out of time, but with Mills's no hitter, you could see the emotion on his face when he found out that Jason had said, nope, I'm staying in, you know, because obviously it was a good time to get him rest. It was a day game. It was a Sunday. And Jason was like, nope, I'm staying in until Millsy goes out. And that clearly meant so much to Mills. And the guys talk all the time about how Jason Hayward's just the best team.
That's why he's here. Well, again, have a wonderful weekend. Gordon, enjoy that gorgeous weather, man. Every day I get to see you on Zoom, it's a good day when I see that sun shining and that crystal clear blue
sky. I'll try to bring
sky.
Some of it home.
It's going to be 50 next week here, kid. We'll be okay. All right. For Gordon, for Maddie, for Tim, for Tony, and for Joe, I'm David Kaplan. This is the Cubs Talk Podcast, brought to you by Wintrust, home of Cubs checking, with three ATMs nationwide. We will see you next time. And don't forget our daily spring training updates from Gordon, Maddie, and Tim. See you.